Have you ever wondered how it can be that Elon Musk is so successful? Well, in this video, we go over 11 lessons learned from Elon so you can be a better engineer and crush it just like him. Hey, 1% Nation, I'm Jake Voorhees, and you are watching episode 27 of the 1% Engineer Show, where we empower young engineers to rise to the top 1% of their career. Elon Musk is the most famous engineer alive today and is responsible for running 5 companies. There's a lot that we can learn from him. I can personally say that he is the biggest role model in my life, and I read his book last year surrounding the controversy of him being on Donald Trump's board, which he held out for a long time and just lately announced that he's stepping down. But if we go back and analyze Elon's life, we can learn so much from him. So I made this video for that reason. Here's a really quick summary of everything that he's done. Of course, you know about Tesla and SpaceX, but a lot of people don't know the other stuff that he's accomplished. Elon is South African born, who moved to Canada when he was 18. He went to Queen's University before transferring to UPenn, where he graduated with 2 degrees, one in physics and one in business. He then moved to California, registered for his PhD, dropped out 2 days later, where his true entrepreneurship journey started. He founded Zip2 with his brother, which eventually exited for $340 million. Elon's take was into the 20 millions, and he then used that momentum to found X.com, which merged with what became PayPal. That sold to Yahoo in 1999 for $1.5 billion. He used that money to start 3 companies all at the same time: Tesla, SpaceX, and Solar City. A lot of people don't know about that one. His 2 cousins run that today, and he's the chairman. All of these ventures were perceived to be mistakes, but they survived because of Elon's hard work. Today in 2017, he's also running The Boring Company, which is responsible for the infrastructure for which the Hyperloop will run. He also founded a venture called Neuralink, which is too complicated for me to explain, so Google it. Here's the 11 lessons from Elon Musk, guys, so you can be a 1% engineer like him.
When you had that third failure in a row, did you think, I need to pack this in?
Never.
Why not?
I don't ever give up. I mean, I'd have to be dead or completely incapacitated.
You need to work super hard. So what does super hard mean? Well, when my brother and I were starting our first company, instead of getting an apartment, we just rented a small office and we slept on the couch. And we showered at the YMCA, and we're so hot up, we had just one computer. So the website was up during the day, and I was coding at night. 7 days a week, all the time. And I sort of briefly had a girlfriend in that period, and in order to be with me, she had to sleep in the office. So work hard, like, every waking hour. If you do simple math, say like, okay, if somebody else is working 50 hours and you're working 100, you'll get twice as much done in the course of a year as the other company.
You want to do projects that are inspiring and that make people excited about the future. Life's got to be about more than just solving problems. You want to get up in the morning and say, yes, I'm looking forward to that thing happening.
Really believe in what you're doing, but not just from a blind faith standpoint. Like, to have really thought about it and say, okay, this is true. I'm convinced it's true. And I've tried every angle to figure out if it's untrue, and sought negative feedback to figure out maybe if I'm maybe wrong. But then after all that, it still seems like this is the right way to go. Then that I think gives one a fundamental conviction and an ability to convey that conviction to others.
Now is the time to take risk. You don't have kids. Your obligation. Well, so, I mean, probably don't have kids. But as you get older, your obligations increase. And once you have a family, you start taking risk not just for yourself, but for your family as well. It gets much harder to do things that might not work out. So now is the time to do that before you have those obligations. So I would encourage you to take risks now. Do something bold. You won't regret it.
Yeah, I think it's important to have a future that is inspiring and appealing. I mean, I just think that there have to be reasons that you get up in the morning and you want to live.
Like, why do you want to live? What's the point? What inspires you? What do you love about the future? And if we're not out there, if the future does not include being out there among the stars and being a multi-planet species, I find that it's incredibly depressing if that's not the future that we're going to have.
You famously said when you were younger there were five problems that you thought were most important for you to work on. Mm-hmm. If you were 22 today, what would the five problems that you would think about working on be?
Well, first of all, I think if somebody is doing something that is useful to the rest of society, I think that's a good thing. Like, it doesn't have to change the world. Like, you know, if you're doing something that has high value to people, and frankly, even if it's something, if it's like just a little game or, you know, some improvement in photo sharing or something, if it has a small amount of good for a large number of people, I think that's fine. Like, stuff doesn't need to be changed the world just to be good.
I think it's also important to reason from first principles rather than by analogy. So the normal way that we conduct our lives is we reason by analogy. We're doing this because it's like something else that was done, mm-hmm. or it's like what other people are doing.
Me too type ideas.
Yeah, slight iterations on a theme. Mm-hmm. It's kind of mentally easier to reason by analogy rather than from first principles. But by first principles is kind of a physics way of looking at the world. And what that really means is you kind of boil things down to the most fundamental truths and say, okay, what are we sure is true or as sure as possible is true? And then reason up from there.
How did you get the expertise to be the chief technology officer of a rocket ship company?
I do have a physics background. That's helpful as a foundation. And then I read a lot of books and talked to a lot of smart people.
You're self-taught?
Yeah. Well, self-taught, yes, meaning I don't have an aerospace degree.
So how did you go about acquiring the knowledge?
Well, I read a lot of books, talked to a lot of people, and have a great team.
You have this incredible sort of scope of ambition, right? Planetary scope, interplanetary scope, right? Yeah. A little more than just changing the world, let's change some other worlds too, right? And this is big stuff. Was that always in your mind, or did you become more emboldened over time that this is available, we can do these things?
It definitely emboldened over time. I mean, when I started the first internet company, Zip2, with my brother and another person, Greg Curry, it wasn't really with the thought of being wealthy. I've got nothing against being wealthy, but
we'll get back to that later too.
but it's just it was just from the standpoint of wanting to be part of the internet and. I figured if we could make enough money to just get by, that would be okay. When we started off, we literally only had like one computer, and so it would be our web server during the day, and I'd code at night. And we just got a small office in Palo Alto back when rent was not insane, it cost us like $450 a month. It was cheaper than an apartment, so we actually just slept in the office and then shower at the YMCA on Page Mill El Camino. So we'd walk over there and shower.
So the first order of business is to figure out how to get there. And it needs to be in a way that enables large numbers of people and cargo. It can't just be like a handful of people, because that's obviously not going to create a self-sustaining civilization. And Apollo was an amazing, inspiring thing for all of humanity, but the last time we went to the moon was like 1973 or 04, I believe. So we don't want to just have flags and footprints and then never go to Mars again. If we just have one mission, that will also be a super inspiring thing, but it's not going to fundamentally change the future of humanity.
Hey, 1% Nation, if you enjoyed these 11 lessons, consider subscribing to this channel because I release videos every Wednesday and Saturday about how you can crush it in your career and become a 1% engineer. Cheers!